Senator Schumer, what did you make of both speeches tonight, and particularly the emphasis on this word compromise? Didn't sound to me like the Republicans are prepared to compromise very much.
Well, they haven't been at all. We've been willing to entertain large spending cuts. Lots of Democrats don't like that. They haven't moved one dime off their stand of no revenues whatsoever. And the president put the blame squarely on the shoulders of where it belongs, a block of extreme right House Republicans who just refuse to compromise at all. And it's leading to disaster. Standard & Poor's, it's reported tonight, said that if we did the Boehner plan, there's a too strong a likelihood of a downgrade. They said the Reid plan wouldn't produce that. And that would be terrible for American families and for the American government. So what we're really asking, I think, is for Speaker Boehner not to follow this extreme group, but to lead a little bit. This group, the 80 to 100 House Republicans, many of them newly elected, who are at the extremes, shouldn't be able to say to the entire country, it's our way or no way. They don't represent the thinking of most of the country.
I mean, we are facing a financial doomsday here if a deal can't be done. The American public are watching you guys all squabbling around and thinking, what the hell is going on? Just get this done. These are our livelihoods at stake when nearly 10% of us are out of work anyway.
Well, if one side is willing to reach out and compromise all the time and the other side says no, it's awfully hard to get it done. And to do what they want, which is a short-term renewal of the debt ceiling, a raising of the debt ceiling, will be back where we started from within a couple of months. And Standard & Poor's is likely to downgrade us, much more likely than under our plan. So we're asking Senate Republicans, many of them have shown a degree of compromise. 16 or 17 of them signed a statement that would entertain revenues as part of the group of six. It's the House Republicans holding this up. But what we're hopeful is, now that the president has gone on national television and put the blame where it belongs, squarely on their shoulders, that one of two things will happen. Either they will yield, although I doubt it, because they're ideologues. But maybe the mainstream of the Republican Party will say, look, for the good of the country, we can't just follow these people. They don't represent a majority.
I mean, there is an option. It's not being tested properly legally. No one seems quite sure if it is a legal option for the president. But under the 14th Amendment, he basically goes alone if it comes to it, rather than default. No default has ever happened before. Would you encourage the president to take that option if all else failed?
Well, I think we ought to avoid that option if we could. It's unclear how the courts would determine it. It's unclear how the credit markets would regard it. It's something that should be explored down the road, perhaps, but not for this scenario. A much better way to go is the Reid compromise. It gives the Republicans what they've asked for. It has no revenues, even though most Democrats and the president want revenues. It says the amount of cuts shall be equal to the amount we raise the debt ceiling. There are other large criteria. So it's sort of an offer they can't refuse, and they won't take yes for an answer. It leads you to wonder, what is going on here? And, you know, when 50 or 60 House Republicans say they think it's probably a good idea not to pay the debt ceiling and default, I think that says it all. The Reid compromise answers every objection they have had. No revenues, an amount of cuts again, equal or to the amount we raised the debt ceiling. And every one of those cuts was approved by the bipartisan negotiations led by Joe Biden. What more do they want?